Penguin Audio presents How Not to Be Wrong, The Power of Mathematical Thinking, written and read by Jordan Ellenberg. What is best in mathematics deserves not merely to be learned as a task, but to be assimilated as a part of daily thought and brought again and again before the mind with ever-renewed encouragement. Bertrand Russell, The Study of Mathematics, 1902. When am I going to use this? Right now, in a classroom somewhere in the world, a student is mouthing off to her math teacher. The teacher has just asked her to spend a substantial portion of her weekend computing a list of 30 definite integrals. There are other things the student would rather do. There is, in fact, hardly anything she would not rather do. She knows this quite clearly because she spent a substantial portion of the previous weekend computing a different, but not very different, list of 30 definite integrals. She doesn't see the point, and she tells her teacher so. And at some point in this conversation, the student is going to ask the question the teacher fears most. When am I going to use this? Now, the math teacher is probably going to say something like, I know this seems dull to you, but remember, you don't know what career you'll choose. You may not see the relevance now, but you might go into a field where it'll be really important that you know how to compute definite integrals quickly and correctly by hand. This answer is seldom satisfying to the student. That's because it's a lie. And the teacher and the student both know it's a lie. The number of adults who will ever make use of the integral of 1 minus 3x plus 4x squared to the negative 2 dx, or the formula for the cosine of 3 theta, or synthetic division of polynomials, can be counted on a few thousand hands. The lie is not very satisfying to the teacher, either. I should know, in my many years as a math professor, I've asked many hundreds of college students to compute lists of definite integrals. Fortunately, there's a better answer. It goes something like this. Mathematics is not just a sequence of computations to be carried out by rote until your patience or stamina runs out, although it might seem that way from what you've been taught in courses called mathematics. Those integrals are to mathematics as weight training and calisthenics are to soccer. If you want to play soccer, I mean really play, at a competitive level, you've got to do a lot of boring, repetitive, apparently pointless drills. Do professional players ever use those drills? Well, you won't see anybody on the field curling a weight or zigzagging between traffic cones. But you do see players using the strength, speed, insight, and flexibility they built up by doing those drills week after tedious week. Learning those drills is part of learning soccer. If you want to play soccer for a living, or even make the varsity team, you're going to be spending lots of boring weekends on the practice field. There's no other way. But now here's the good news. If the drills are too much for you to take, you can still play for fun with friends. You can enjoy the thrill of making a slick pass between defenders or scoring from distance just as much as a pro athlete does. You'll be healthier and happier than you would be if you sat home watching the professionals on TV. Mathematics is pretty much the same. You may not be aiming for a mathematically oriented career. That's fine, most people aren't. But you can still do math. You probably already are doing math, even if you don't call it that. Math is woven into the way we reason, and math makes you better at things. Knowing mathematics is like wearing a pair of X-ray specs that reveal hidden structures underneath the messy and chaotic surface of the world. Math is a science of not being wrong about things, its techniques and habits hammered out by centuries of hard work and argument. With the tools of mathematics in hand, you can understand the world in a deeper, sounder, and more meaningful way. All you need is a coach, or even just a book, to teach you the rules and some basic tactics. I will be your coach. I will show you how. For reasons of time, this is seldom what I actually say in the classroom. But in a book, there's room to stretch out a little more. I hope to back up the grand claims I just made by showing you that the problems we think about every day, problems of politics, of medicine, of commerce, of theology, are shot through with mathematics. Understanding this gives you access to insights accessible by no other means. Even if I did give my student the full inspirational speech, she might, if she is really sharp, remain unconvinced. That sounds good, professor, she'll say, but it's pretty abstract. You say that with mathematics at your disposal, you can get things right you'd otherwise get wrong. But what kind of things? Give me an actual example. And at that point, I would tell her the story of Abraham Wald and the missing bullet holes. Abraham Wald and the missing bullet holes. This story, like many World War II stories, starts with the Nazis hounding a Jew out of Europe and ends with the Nazis regretting it. Abraham Wald was born in 1902 in what was then the city of Klausenburg in what was then the Austro-Hungarian Empire. By the time Wald was a teenager, One World War was in the books and his hometown had become Cluj, Romania. He was the grandson of a rabbi and the son of a kosher baker, but the younger Wald was a mathematician almost from the start. His talent for the subject was quickly recognized, and he was admitted to study mathematics at the University of Vienna, where he was drawn to subjects abstract and recondite even by the standards of pure mathematics, set theory, and metric spaces. But when Wald's studies were completed, it was the mid-1930s, Austria was deep in economic distress, and there was no possibility that a foreigner could be hired as a professor in Vienna. Wald was rescued by a job offer from Oscar Morgenstern. Morgenstern would later immigrate to the United States and help invent game theory, but in 1933, he was the director of the Austrian Institute for Economic Research, and he hired Wald at a small salary to do mathematical odd jobs. That turned out to be a good move for Wald. His experience in economics got him a fellowship offer at the Coles Commission, an economic institute then located in Colorado Springs. Despite the ever-worsening political situation, Wald was reluctant to take a step that would lead him away from pure mathematics for good. But then the Nazis conquered Austria, making Wald's decision substantially easier. After just a few months in Colorado, he was offered a professorship of statistics at Columbia. He packed up once again and moved to New York. And that was where he fought the war. The Statistical Research Group, or SRG, where Wald spent much of World War II, was a classified program that yoked the assembled might of American statisticians to the war effort. Something like the Manhattan Project, except the weapons being developed were equations, not explosives. And the SRG was actually in Manhattan, at 401 West 118th Street in Morningside Heights, just a block away from Columbia University. The building now houses Columbia faculty apartments and some doctor's offices, but in 1943, it was the buzzing, sparking nerve center of wartime math. At the Applied Mathematics Group Columbia, dozens of young women bent over Marchant desktop calculators were calculating formulas for the optimal curve a fighter should trace out through the air in order to keep an enemy plane in its gun sights. In another apartment, a team of researchers from Princeton was developing protocols for strategic bombing, and Columbia's wing of the atom bomb project was right next door. But the SRG was the most high-powered and ultimately the most influential of any of these groups. The atmosphere combined the intellectual openness and intensity of an academic department with the shared sense of purpose that comes only with high stakes. When we made recommendations, W. Allen Wallace, the director, wrote, frequently things happened. Fighter planes entered combat with their machine guns loaded according to Jack Wolfowitz's recommendations about mixing types of ammunition, and maybe the pilots came back or maybe they didn't. Navy planes launched rockets whose propellants had been accepted by Abe Gershick's sampling inspection plans, and maybe the rockets exploded and destroyed our own planes and pilots, or maybe they destroyed the target. The mathematical talent on hand was equal to the gravity of the task. In Wallace's words, the SRG was the most extraordinary group of statisticians ever organized, taking into account both number and quality. Frederick Mosteller, who would later found Harvard's statistics department, was there. So was Leonard Jimmy Savage, the pioneer of decision theory and great advocate of the field that came to be called Bayesian statistics. Savage, by the way, was almost totally blind, able to see only out of one corner of one eye, and at one point spent 6 months living only on pemmican in order to prove a point about Arctic exploration. Just thought that was worth mentioning. Norbert Wiener, the MIT mathematician and the creator of cybernetics, dropped by from time to time. This was a group where Milton Friedman, the future Nobelist in economics, was often the fourth smartest person in the room. The smartest person in the room was usually Abraham Wald. Wald had been Alan Wallace's teacher at Columbia and functioned as a kind of mathematical eminence to the group. Still an enemy alien, he was not technically allowed to see the classified reports he was producing. The joke around SRG was that the secretaries were required to pull each sheet of notepaper out of his hands as soon as he was finished writing on it. Wald was, in some ways, an unlikely participant. His inclination, as it always had been, was toward abstraction and away from direct applications. But his motivation to use his talents against the Axis was obvious. And when you needed to turn a vague idea into solid mathematics, Wald was the person you wanted at your side. So here's the question. You don't want your planes to get shot down by enemy fighters, so you armor them. But armor makes the plane heavier, and heavier planes are less maneuverable and use more fuel. Armoring the planes too much is a problem. Armoring the planes too little is a problem. Somewhere in between, there's an optimum. The reason you have a team of mathematicians socked away in an apartment in New York City is to figure out where that optimum is. The military came to the SRG with some data they thought might be useful. When American planes came back from engagements over Europe, they were covered.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.